So it's me next. So I'll basically just introduce myself. I think I already have done to an extent. So basically, I've worked as a practitioner, a researcher, and a lecturer in the social work field for over 30 years. As a qualified social worker in the UK, I've practiced in a broad number of fields, including all aspects of statutory children and families work. I was never an adoption worker. I will clarify that before I start. But I certainly worked in the child protection field. I also worked ended up working in disability services. I completed my Master's in Socio-Legal Studies in 1998. I've got a strong interest in social justice and the inclusion and empowerment of people who get marginalised in participatory action research. All research done in these kinds of areas should be participatory. Whilst in Australia, I completed my PhD in 2012 at Sydney University. At that point, working with young adults who have Down syndrome to look at how they were, the opportunities that they were getting to integrate and to participate in wider society. So that was my, if you like, specialism. My current interests, I'm currently writing a book on human rights. I've got a book contract with Oxford University Press, writing about social work and human rights in Australia, so which is an exciting opportunity. And that proposal really was inspired to a large extent by the work that I'd done with those young adults with disabilities, but also my work with Origins as well, and some of the advocacy work and the consciousness raising and whatever that's happened in this particular campaign. So thanks to everybody. Thanks to you all for inspiring that. And it's still a work in progress. I'm a bit behind with this. So basically they're my interests at the moment. So what I'm going to do today is just hopefully quite quickly, and there is a lot of synergies I think all of us find in that there are quite a lot of synergies in terms of what people are saying today, aren't there? There's quite a few common threads emerging. So basically, can you all hear me?
Yes. Okay.
So basically, this presentation, it might be a bit long, so Sabrina and Chloe might have to pull me off the stage with a cane, you know. I've told all the other speakers, look, you know, make sure your time, make sure you're well organised. But with everything else going on, this has been a bit long, but I will flick through some bits if speakers have already, you know, come with this information. But I am aware that there will be people here who know different bits and parts of information, so I just wanted to give an overview of some issues, particularly for professionals. So it's called a critical professional reflection. So I want to acknowledge the ground on which we're holding this meeting and pay my respects to the traditional owners of the land on which we meet and to elders past, present and future. I also want to acknowledge that this is a very painful area for many people here today due to the past and present trauma and the continuing cycles of grief and loss. That's coming out all the time of what people are saying. Please take time out if you need to. And this presentation I'm going to dedicate to my dad, Ron Stevenson, who was an activist in Sheffield in the north of England, where I come from. been here 11 years now. But my dad was actually put on a boat to South Africa from the UK when he was 5 years old in the war. And he was brought back when he was 14 at the end of the war. So we did have some, again, my family has been touched by that, some of that maternal deprivation and separation. I'm dedicating this to my dad and all families of loss. So why do all professionals need to critically reflect? So critical thinking for social work, said Agius, is that we question values, assumptions, underlying knowledge, theories, practice, research, questions, and make judgments about the relevance and validity of information. This is what professionals should do. It's the basis of good clinical decision making, and it's required to make ethical decisions, to reason ethically and make ethical decisions. And it's needed for practicing organisations if social workers are to retain their professional integrity in the face of pressure to become organisational apparatchiks. And apparatchiks is a funny term, it's an American term that Agliassi is using here, but he's basically an apparatchik, he's somebody who blindly follows orders. And I think that has happened a lot in a lot of these issues. And it's also, I feel, all professionals, researchers, policymakers, legal personnel need to critically reflect. Critical reflection also means that we continue to learn. It might mean that we change from one point of view to another. That's not a bad thing. What is a bad thing is if you learn something and you don't change your view, or people are shouting at you to learn something or hear something and you don't hear them. It's okay, right? And it's really important that to avoid abusing professional power, which is another theme of that runs right through people suffering family separation, some of these big issues. So the areas that I'm going to cover very much quickly touch on are the history, the context, look at a bit of research, lived experience and voice, human rights and ethics and lessons from overseas, and then look at some outcomes and risks. So I'm just touching on a number of areas here. Obviously it's not exhaustive, but hopefully just sparks some further thinking. But a general observation then, thinking about adoption, is that for decades in social work training, education, research and practice, adoption as an option for care of children has been normalised. Okay? So it's there on the table, and it's seen as a normal option for the care of a child, right? I.e., very few social work educators and practitioners deeply question, and this, and I'm sorry to say this is still the case, deeply question, and I mean at that very deep level where you're saying, actually, what mistakes have been made? Am I listening to research? Deeply question adoption's right to exist. Okay. So adoption, and it's been said, I think, before me, that adoption sort of still sits there as some kind of sacred cow. You know, that we've got to, yeah, it's still going to be there, but we'll do different things with it, and we'll kind of make it work somehow, you know. But we've not questioned its right to exist, as Catherine and others think has been very much more articulate than me in terms of saying that. The history as well of Australia. So in previous years, Australia's had a number of groundbreaking federal and state inquiries, brilliant inquiries, with a lot of people amazingly and courageously sharing some really deep stuff, deep information, followed by numerous apologies into the stolen generations, the former child migrants, the forgotten Australians, and forced adoption. So you've got in here all these inquiries engaged with and exposed the devastating realities of what can happen to children, families and communities when policymakers and state agencies bring about separation from family of origin. Now, somebody might say, well, abuse does happen in families. People do. Yes, it does. But when the state takes action, it's a different ballgame. It's a different issue altogether, because you are meddling, if you're not careful, you are meddling in other people's lives, and you've got to make very, very responsible decisions about that. Families can make mistakes. That happens. Okay. So there are also intersecting histories in a British colony, and I think, and Jim's articulated this beautifully as well, is that the lived experiences of the stolen generation, the former child migrants, the forgotten Australians and citizens affected by forced adoption practices intersect at many points. Sometimes when I was working with forgotten Australians, there would be people who were of Aboriginal heritage and non-Aboriginal heritage in the same homes, being friends with each other sometimes, running away with each other. I remember two children did once. So there are intersecting histories. Obviously, every group's got its own particular strong issues, but shared histories. And also common experiences of forced removal, abuse, separation from family and community, and incarceration in care homes, resulting in deculturation and intergenerational trauma. Because everybody has culture, everybody has a culture. that they have a right to. Forced adoption. So what are the lessons? Again, thinking critically, being a bit critically reflective as a professional. How could it happen and why did it happen? So we had the social mores argument, and I think most of you are familiar with this concept that some commentators have used the argument that babies were removed because of the social mores of the time. So that means the contemporaneous social unacceptability, shame, stigma of unmarried motherhood impacting on the mother and her own family. And that was often used in what I call the grooming process of the mother when she entered some of these, quite innocent girls with rights at the time entered unmarried mothers' homes. They were actually groomed to relinquish babies with the notions of shame, stigma, it's not okay. But looking back, and this is when you study the history, right from as far back as 1938, that's 78 years ago, child welfare investigations in Geneva said, and I won't read all these out, but social workers have usually found that it is happier for the child to have one parent than to be an orphan. And in the case of an illegitimate child, it's often the best thing for the mother to be allowed to keep him. That was back in 1938. 1944, Constance Duncan of the Commonwealth Health Department, in her research to the National Health and Medical Research Council of Australia, which is the highest authority, or certainly was at the time, of medical research in Australia, reported in 1944, all authorities have agreed that not only is it beneficial from the baby's point of view that the mother should keep the child, but to ensure the rehabilitation of the girl, again, apologies for language that was used at the time, it's essential that she assumes responsibility for her baby. That was said 72 years ago as well. So to say that people kind of didn't know then but know better now doesn't quite cut it. And then you've got, obviously, Mr. White, the Australian Minister for Health, introduced or increased benefits for unmarried mothers. Oh, I know. So what happened then? So there was different elements, I think, and people have mentioned different movers around why forced adoption occurred. Part of that was a professional movement. It was led by professionals. And anybody who studied the history will know that, shamefully. So we got a visitor from, Australia got, I wasn't here then, in 1953, Miss Margaret Thornhill came from America. And this is just one example of a person, said that the most able, competent, I can't do an American accent, and better adjusted unmarried mothers are the ones who give up their babies for adoption. This is what she said, this is a direct quote from the paper, and I've put all the references here, you can go and look them up. Miss Thornhill, this is interesting. So Miss Thornhill was in Australia on a Fulbright scholarship, which is a very prestigious American scholarship, okay, to do research. I've never found a research paper of Margaret Thornhill's today. If anybody ever finds a research paper by her, please send it to me because I've looked and I can't find one. But what she did do after that was hold a conference in 1955 in the USA. And they were, as far as I can remember, you can find this document, it's very interesting on the internet. And it's called Protecting Children in Adoption. So the Association of Child Protection and Adoption was very much mooted in this conference, and it was quite an important one. I think there were attendees from Australia and other countries as well, Britain, Australia, whatever. So it was almost a bit of, you know, why are these people getting together at this point in time? Basically, there was a marked shift in attitude, and this is a very good book by Clark E. Vincent, which Lily showed me, and I rushed off and got my own copy from Amazon. Do get one if you can, because it's actually very good research, and Clark E. Vincent reflects very deeply on some of these issues, and he predicted what was going to happen. And he said, removal in the best interest of the child, as we've heard. And he said that when he was reflecting, he said, policy like this, which is removal, will be implemented through such pressures and labels as scientific findings. Well, research says the best interests of the child, the rehabilitation of the unwed mother, and the stability of the family and society. Very predictive, isn't it? But hang on, in 1959 we had probably the first significant United Nations Declaration on the Rights of the Child. Now, I've just basically listed some of the principles that are really relevant to what we're talking about today from that first declaration. It was followed up by the 1989 Convention on the Rights of the Child, which is a much more detailed document, much more binding in lots of ways. But let's just look at this in 1959. The third principle was that the child should be entitled from his birth to a name and a nationality. And a name. I think that means something.
What's adopted by Australia?
A name and a nationality. Also in principle four, you notice that the special care and protection of the child, there was recommended that special care and protection of the child shall be provided both to him and to his mother. Because as well, as other speakers have said, you know, giving birth, being pregnant, giving birth, and that first, certainly that first year after birth, first few years after birth, a mother is incredibly vulnerable. And she does fall quite well. I think Catherine beautifully named that the mother-child dyad. But I would also like to add to this as well, fathers are vulnerable. A missing voice has been that of the fathers too. And Cam's going to talk to us about that after lunch. But just to say that these principles sat there, they should, wherever possible, grow up in the care and under the responsibility of his parents. And I think this does mean natural parents. You know, parents. And a child of tender years, very significantly, a child of 7 years shall not, save in the exceptional circumstances, be separated from his mother. So even that was mentioned in this declaration. And yet the forced adoption didn't peak in Australia until much later. So again, approximately 150,000 mothers lost babies. There was the involvement of many church agencies, but no biblical justification for a removal of a child from an unmarried mother whatsoever. So one goes, why did they get involved then? In terms of research, can we afford to avoid or discount the issues generated by adoption, and whose needs are actually served by adoption? And so there's a bit of research there in terms of adoption filling can fill an emotional, spiritual, and psychological void in families. Whether those needs are actually met is debatable as well. You know, a lot of adoptive parents have had a bad time as well. Gregson claimed that it takes adopted children about 10 to 15 years of abstract thinking to fully comprehend what adoption means in their life. And that means as well that abstract thinking, if you look at Piaget's model of abstract thinking, that means that kind of starts when a child is about 11 to 15 years. So we're going to say that the next 15 years or more of their life is going to be dedicated to this child, you know, making sense of what's happened to them. Is that acceptable? So is that sensible? Smith, this was really interesting. This is a paper written by an adoptive mother, and quite a startling statistic here. This is from the States. Adopted children represent 2% of all children in the USA, yet 4 to 5% of children referred to out of home outpatient mental health clinics, and 10 to 15% of children in residential care facilities are adopted. So that's for mental health residential care facilities there. 10 to 15%, that was back in 2002. But that's a lot of children, that's a lot of young people who've been adopted as a percentage. Silverstein and Rosie have identified core issues which relate to adoption and loss, grief and rejection, with accompanying feelings of guilt, shame and identity issues. They just pile up and up and up. So I'm not going to force that home anymore. Mm-hmm. But shouldn't we question? This is, I think what stood out to me was that she said this: these core issues do not imply that the institution of adoption is pathological. Rather, these expected issues evolve logically out of the child's experience of adoption. Mm-hmm. Just doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm. Shouldn't we question the institution of adoption then very deeply? Mm-hmm. There's a Swedish study there which talks about increased risk for suicide attempts and suicide rates, particularly in international adoptees, but also national adoptees. As well, as Linda just mentioned, there's some very, coming to the present, there's now some very worrying legislative changes in New South Wales. With not only is the, are we getting these time-limited periods for babies to be adopted, where, say, a mother and father have got to tackle quite a significant substance addiction or whatever. They've been given up to only 6 months if the child is under a year. And that the clock starts ticking on that 6 months from the point that an interim care order is made. Okay, when the child is over a year, they allow a year for that process to happen. And furthermore to that, what FACTS, and this is just in New South Wales as I know it, is actively promoting adoption from care. These two amendments mean that a person who's authorised as a foster carer is also at the same time approved as a potential adopter. In the past, you used to have to be approved as an adopter or approved as a foster carer. The two roles were seen as very different. Now they've been conflated in that legislation. Okay, so that's a lot of concern there. So other issues, so rehabilitation, and when I first qualified, I worked at a rehab in the UK, and take it from me, and I'm sure there'll be people with a lot of knowledge and information about this in the audience as well. I would say rehabilitation from a serious issue, a serious substance misuse issue, whether it be alcohol or drugs or whatever, is probably within the region of 18 months to 2 years. Yeah. Okay, so I'm just going to go, before I take questions, I think there was a question about, well, what is the face of the future? There are models in, I think William's talked about Australian stewardship. There are models of that the UK are using in terms of special guardianship orders in the UK, which again are short of changing the child's identity, are short of that some of the problems and that kind of severance that comes with adoption. And the good thing about, if you look at the, I would urge you to look at the information about special guardianship in the UK, because not only is it pretty well developed, it also entitles the guardian and their families and the child to services as well, ongoing support services, to support that arrangement, okay? So is this the face of the future? Child protection issues, foster care, open adoption, and how long does open adoption last as well? I think most people know as well that typically at the current time, open adoption generally means, apart from other communications and contacts, 3 or 4 direct contacts with the child per year for a parent, okay? 3 or 4. So not very, very open. This is my idea, really. I guess from my reflection, these were some ideas I came up to because I wanted to finish on a positive note. So I think we need to have a paradigm which is learning, constantly learning and relearning lessons from the past. Let's look at providing holistic and sustainable family support services for people, okay? There's a lot of short-termism that goes on. We need to balance children's rights and family rights. We need children's legislation, anything to concern the welfare of children should be at federal level to get some consistency going. Statutory visitation and independent monitoring of children, I was going to talk more about that, but we've got a lot of children who are going into the care system who are not being monitored properly, who are not being certainly statutorily. And I've talked about this to a lot of agencies. they said, yes, but we do do that, you know, that's good practice, but that's not the same as it being by statute as well. And we also need a system of independent monitoring and review of children. So a completely independent person comes into a fostering situation, or certainly an adoption, if they're going to have this open adoption situation. And basically, and have and listen to what the child's saying. Talk to the natural parents. Talk to the foster carers and whatever. Find out how that child's doing, because what I used to be a reviewing officer, and one of the questions I always used to ask at every review was, does this child still need to be in foster care? You know, is anything being done to assist parents to bring about family reunion? If you've no independent reviewing officer, those questions can't be asked, you know. Okay, so, and the other one as well, our stewardship and guardianship models and support again. Okay, so I'll let you go now. I hope I've not burnt your ears off too much. But thank you all for listening, and we're about ready for lunch. Okay, everybody. Okay, I'm going to hand the mic now to Lily Arthur, who's going to pay tribute to Down Welfare and launch Down's book. Oh.